អង្គុយចុះអង្គជំនុំជម្រះប្រកាសបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការនីតិវិធីសមនការនៅសមនការនៅថ្ងៃនេះអង្គជំនុំធ្វើសមនការស្ដាប់សេចក្តីកម្មដើមដឹងរដ្ឋបាលពិនីដែលមានហៅនាម PTCCP 252ហើយមុននឹងស្ដាប់សេចក្តីកម្មសាកសីអង្គជំនុំនឹងស្ដាប់បឋមអំពីកម្មវត្ថុនៃសំណើសុំរបស់លោកមេធាវីគុជវិទ្យាកូពេដែលប៉ុនប៉ងលើកកាលពីម្សិលមិញហើយរួមទាំងពេលវេលាដែលត្រូវធ្វើសេចក្តីថ្លែងការណ៍ពាក់ព័ន្ធជាមួយនឹងការបង្ហាញអំពីសំណើនិងមូលហេតុនៃសំណើសុំទាំងរបស់ខ្លួនរបស់លោកផងអក្រមជាសមនការលោកស្រីកញ្ញាជាទីហងឡារីការអំពីស្ថានភាពវត្តមានអវត្តមានភាគីនិងបុគ្គលនៃអង្គជំរះក៏អញ្ជើញចូលរួមនៅក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសមនការថ្ងៃនេះ
សូមគោរពលោកប្រធានសម្រាប់សវនកម្មនៅថ្ងៃនេះកាលាបញ្ជីក៏សម្គាល់ឃើញថាគ្រប់ភាគីទាំងអស់នៃរឿងក្តីនេះមានវត្តមានដោយឡែកលោកនួនជាមានវត្តមាននៅបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនខាងក្រោមសាសវនកម្មនេះដោយលោកស្នាសុំលះបងសិទ្ធមានវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់នៅក្នុងបន្ទប់សវនកម្មលិខិតលះបងសិទ្ធរបស់លោកនួនជាបានប្រកល់ដល់កាលាបញ្ជីរួចហើយដើមមិនដឹងដែលត្រូវមកផ្ដល់សេចក្តីកម្មនៅថ្ងៃនេះមានរហស្សនាម PTCCP 252ដើមបណ្ដឹងរូបនេះមានវត្តមាននៅក្នុងបន្ទប់រងចាំរងចាំការកោះហៅពីអង្គជំនុំជម្រះសូមអរគុណលោកប្រធាន
ណាអរគុណស៊ីហួងដែលជាបឋមនេះអង្គជំរះសម្រាប់លើសំណើសុំរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាជាមុនសិនអង្គជំរះបានទទួលលិខិតសំលះបងសិទ្ធចូលរួមសកម្មការដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការនេះរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចុះថ្ងៃទី17ខែកញ្ញាឆ្នាំ2015ដែលបានបញ្ជាក់ថាដែលគាត់មានបញ្ហាសុខភាពឈឺក្បាលឈឺចង្កេះមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបានមិនអាចផ្ចង់អារម្មណ៍បានយូរនិងដើម្បីមានលទ្ធភាពចូលរួមសកម្មការនាថ្ងៃខាងមុខឲ្យមានប្រសិទ្ធភាពខ្លួនធំលះបង់សិទ្ធនិងមានវត្តមានដែលផ្ទាល់ក្នុងបន្ទប់សកម្មការនៅថ្ងៃទី17ខែកញ្ញាឆ្នាំ2015បានឃើញកំណត់ហេតុពិនិត្យសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាធ្វើឡើងដោយគ្រូពេទ្យប្រចាំការពិនិត្យព្យាបាលថែទាំសុខភាពជនជាប់ចោតនៅអវតកចុះថ្ងៃទី17ខែកញ្ញាឆ្នាំ2015ដែលបានកត់សម្គាល់អំពីស្ថានភាពសុខភាពរបស់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាថ្ងៃនេះថាមានអាការៈឈឺចង្កេះរ៉ាំរ៉ៃហើយមិនអាចអង្គុយយូរបាននិងផ្ដល់អនុសាសន៍ថាសូមអង្គជម្រះអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យលោកនួនជាចូលរួមតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីបន្ទប់ខាងក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះផ្អែកលើមូលដ្ឋាននេះនឹងយោងតាមបទបញ្ញត្តិនៃវិធាន81/5នៃវិធានផ្ទៃក្នុងអវតកអង្គជម្រះយល់ព្រមនិងអនុញ្ញាតឲ្យជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីចម្ងាយពីបន្ទប់ឃុំខ្លួនមួយស្ថិតនៅក្រោមសាលសកម្មការនេះតាមរយៈឧបករណ៍សោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់រយៈពេលសកម្មការពេញមួយថ្ងៃនេះប្រកបដោយបុគ្គលិកផ្នែកសោទស្សន៍ភ្ជាប់ប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍សម្រាប់ជនជាប់ចោតនួនជាអាចចូលរួមនឹងតាមដានកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការពីចម្ងាយតាមរយៈប្រព័ន្ធសោទស្សន៍ក្នុងកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មការសម្រាប់ថ្ងៃនេះបច្ចុប្បន្នទៅនេះមុននឹងឈានដល់ការស្ដាប់នៅសេចក្តីកម្មដើមម្ដងរដ្ឋនីតិរូបអង្គការផ្ដាល់វិទ្យាជួនទៅមេធាវីបច្ចកូពីសូមឲ្យបង្ហាញបឋមទី1ថាតើសំណើបញ្ហាអ្វីខ្លះដែលលោកមានបំណងទី2ថាតើប្រប៉ានប៉ាន់ប្រមាណនៃពេលវេលាដែលលោកនឹងធ្វើតេដីថ្លែងការអំពីបង្ហាញមូលហេតុនិងសំអាងហេតុនៃការសំណើសុំរបស់លោកនោះប្រហែលជាត្រូវការចំណាយពេលវេលាប៉ុន្មាន
Thank you, Mr. President. Good morning, Your Honours. Good morning, Council.
I anticipate between 10 and 15 minutes. Lok Tien khiem trou ka pel velia 15 niti.
Ba som chei, Lok Metvi.
Thank you. Mr. President, two days ago,the international co-prosecutor, Mr. Nicholas Kunjan, filed a request to call three additional witnesses in respect of the treatment of Cham. That request was signed by him only, no signature of the National Co-Prosecutor Chia Lang appears on the document with number E-366. Two of the three witnesses mentioned in E-366 had already been requested by both the International Co-Prosecutor and the National Co-Prosecutor. They had done so on the 9th of May 2014. And that is also why two of the three witnesses were given DCW numbers. One is 2DCW938 and one is 2DCW894. And the most important one seems to be 2DCW938. This witness has already testified in this very courtroom before the chamber in case 002/01. That was in early 2012. Mr. President, I'm being a bit vague as to the exact date in order to ensure that I do not reveal the identity of the witness. In the request from International Co-Prosecutor Khun Jam, we can read that 2DCW938 has testified another five times in case 4. And this testimony was gathered in 2013. And that evidence was subsequently placed on the case file of case 4 in December 2014. It was then disclosed to the defense and other parties in our case in February 2015 and admitted into evidence on 17 July 2015. However, the chamber has had decided in August 2015, last month, not to summons 2DCW938 and 2DCW894. According to the International Co-Prosecutor, these two witnesses can now offer, quote unquote, critical evidence of the existence of a plan to systematically destroy Cham as a group, as well as quote unquote details of how the plan was passed down the hierarchy from Sector 41 to the district and commune levels for implementation. Unquote. According to the International Co-Prosecutor, the evidence goes to, quote again, the central issue in this case, whether the mass killings of the Cham people were conducted pursuant to a policy of the CPK leaders. Accordingly, 2TCW938 and the other witness, 2TCW894, are in the view of the International Co-Prosecutor, quoting again, perhaps the two most important witnesses for this trial segment. Unquote. Considering the, quoting again, significance of the evidence, as well as the centrality of this evidence to the critical issues behind the targeting of the Cham and other groups, it is in the view of the International Co-Prosecutor, quote, imperative to summon these witnesses. Now, having summarized this request, we have first two requests for clarification. As I just said, 2TCW938 has already testified in this courtroom. And as I said, this witness was subsequently requested by both the International and National Co-Prosecutor in case 002/02. The question that I'm seeking clarification of is, why is it now only the International Co-Prosecutor requesting to summon this witness? I would like to inquire today with the National Co-Prosecutor why it is that she Chialang did not co-sign the E366 request. What has changed between May 2014 and now? Mr. President, I would also like to know from the national co-prosecutor if, according to Cambodian law, it is legally possible for the international co-prosecutor to request the trial chamber to summons a witness without, I presume, the apparent consent of the national co-prosecutor. Now, Mr. President, the defense realizes that in the segment on Krang Tachan, District Secretary Boon, you might remember her, was requested only by the international co-prosecutor. But that was, we believe, a different situation, because she had never testified before in case 002, let alone appear in this courtroom during the 002/01 trial. In addition to this, the national co-prosecutor has first jointly asked for two TCW 938 with her international counterpart, and now all of a sudden, not anymore. And of course also the fact that we didn't raise this issue with witness Boon at the time doesn't of course mean we cannot raise this legal matter now. So my request, Mr. President, is to the national co-prosecutor to please explain to us what the law is so that we can revisit the issue when we file our written submissions in response to the request. The second point we seek clarification on is with the international co-prosecutor. Why is the question? Why file this request now? Why so late? Why ask for these witnesses now when we are in the middle of hearing evidence on what allegedly happened with the charm in part of Sector 41? Mr. International Co-Prosecutor, you have been sitting on this evidence as early as December 2014, and we would really appreciate an explanation. We actually find it quite incredible that so long was waited. And having heard your answer today, we would be happy to then incorporate your answer into, again, our written submissions. And that, Mr. President, brings me to an even four more fundamental issue, and that's the following. I shall be honest, as I'm always, but this time even a little bit more. We didn't see the request, this particular request, from the international co-prosecutor coming. We were actually completely taken by surprise. Of course, in theory, we could have known the existence of this evidence that the international prosecutor calls so critical and crucial. But the truth is, we didn't. In the tsunami of 8,155 pages coming from the approximately 500 individuals who have given testimony in case 4 and which have been disclosed to us since the beginning of the second trial against our client, it was simply buried. It hadn't come up, excuse me. It hadn't come up in our PDF searches, and as a matter of fact, our one and only international intern had literally stumbled upon the evidence of two TCW 938 literally half an hour before the notification of E366. Now the question, of course, is why is that? How is that possible? It's possible simply because up until now, we have not been able to really read those 8,000 plus pages. The only thing we can do, and have been doing so far, is do dedicated word searches in these thousands of pages. We do not have the time or the resources to read this flood of case 4 evidence, case 004 evidence. Mr. President, as you are well aware, we are having a relentless trial schedule with no breaks between the segments. For instance, there was literally zero pause between the segments on the work site, segment on the work site, and the segment on the treatment of the charm. In addition, and maybe even more important, we are also in full preparation for the upcoming appeal hearings. Only last Friday, we filed probably one of our most important submissions since 2008 with the Supreme Court chamber. It was a highly densely formulated request that took us considerable resources to write. Not sure if I'm right now, but I think we do take some comfort from the fact that it appears that also the trial chamber itself might not have seen the request from the international co-prosecutor coming. Otherwise, I presume both 2 TCW 938 and 2 TCW 894 would surely have made it to the witness list regarding the segment of the charm. Mr. President, what I'm saying is, in fact, that we are pulling the emergency brake. We simply cannot do it anymore. Either we are given extra resources immediately, or we should stop hearing evidence on the charm right now, and you allow us to really read and process the evidence from case 4. And more importantly, actually discuss, enable us to discuss the evidence with our client and get his input, which we still have not been able to do. And that, Mr. President, brings me to my last point. And it is also a very important point. While we are hearing evidence today, yesterday, last week, as to what happened to the charm in one particular district in Sector 41, the investigators in case 004 are now, as we speak, questioning apparently crucial witnesses in relation to one of the suspects in case 004. They are investigating right now genocide charges against him in relation to Sector 41. The very Ta'an to whom two of the witnesses this week were referring to in the testimony. So what allegedly happened in, at Wat Othrakun is part of that case 004 investigation right now. And allow me to refer you to paragraphs 23 to 25 of the case 004 introductory submissions regarding Aung. They're not part of the case file, but you can find these submissions in the public domain on internet. So the investigators in case 004 are apparently looking for evidence to establish the existence of a genocidal policy against the charm in Sector 41. They are looking at other districts in Sector 41. They are looking at other security centers in Sector 41. They are looking at the hierarchical structure in Sector 41, both downwards from the sector to the districts and communes, and upwards from the sector to the central and standing committee of the CPK. It is very possible that there is exculpatory evidence being gathered today, or maybe even yesterday, or maybe tomorrow. Now, Mr. President, we believe that there is a crucial difference with the Tra Phieng Thma Dam worksite in the Northwest Zone. You know that there were also kinds of issues about the evidence coming from case 4 in relation to this worksite. The crucial difference is we have not been disputing the existence of the dam. We have not been disputing the decision by our client and others to have that particular dam or the first January dam built. Now, of course, we didn't present our documents at the document hearing, but if we would have, it would have been clear to you, to all of us, that we are not disputing a policy to build dams and work sites. However, we are strenuously disputing the existence of a policy of genocide against the Cham. Therefore, Mr. President, and I'm rounding up, we request to stop hearing evidence on the Cham in respect of Wat Ottak Kun in Phim Chi Commune until the investigation against An has been closed and all relevant evidence has been disclosed and seen by the defense. Alternatively, we request that the chamber only hears evidence on the treatment of the Cham in the former East Zone, since that zone is not part of the investigation against An. One last remark. In addition, please be informed, Mr. President, that we will soon be requesting to hear additional witnesses in relation to the treatment of the Cham in the East Zone. That request is almost finished, and we will circulate a courtesy copy probably coming Monday. But that's aside of the main issues that I would like to raise in relation to the request from the prosecution, from the international co-prosecutor 2 days ago. Thank
you.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Bonjour à la Chambre et bonjour à l'ensemble des partis. Comme je l'ai indiqué par mail hier, il me semble, nous n'avons pas l'intention de répondre sur le fond à la requête du procureur. Nous allons le faire par écrit, comme nous l'avons indiqué. Je me dois cependant de faire quelques remarques compte tenu de ce que vient de dire mon confrère Copé, parce que vous le comprendrez, il y a un lien direct avec les dernières écritures que nous avions déposées, et notamment notre sur les obligations de communication des coprocureurs E363. On est exactement dans la configuration d'un moment clé de la procédure, j'ai envie de dire, parce que la question fondamentale est de savoir comment vous continuez un procès si, jour après jour, il y a une introduction continuelle d'éléments d'une instruction en cours. Ce que vient de dire mon confrère Coupé, nous l'avons déjà dit dans nos écritures, sur la masse des documents, la possibilité ou pas de pouvoir les analyser, mais au-delà de ça, au-delà des problèmes matériels et pratiques, il y a encore une fois la question du principe. Est-ce que dans un procès en cours, on peut intégrer au fil des jours des éléments relatifs à une instruction qui n'est pas terminée? C'est un problème de fond, c'est un problème qui va malheureusement se poser tout au long du procès si on ne trouve pas une véritable solution. Notre requête E363 vise à trouver une solution qui permettrait d'éviter que du retard soit pris dans le cadre de ce procès, qui permettrait également de respecter une procédure dans le cadre d'un procès qui a fait l'objet d'une instruction. Et là, je renvoie à nos dernières écritures en réponse à l'accusation, et j'en resterai là, qui est de savoir si ce que les coprocureurs nous disent. De fait, en introduisant sans arrêt des éléments qui sont normalement capitaux, disent-ils, mais qui n'ont pas été traités dans le cadre de l'instruction, alors là, nous avons un vrai problème. Est-ce que ça veut dire que l'instruction a été mal faite? Est-ce que ça veut dire que les enquêtes ont été mal faites? Est-ce que ça veut dire que l'instruction, même dans le procès 02, barre 2 n'est pas terminée? Alors que faisons-nous ici? Je resterai là de mes observations. Je renvoie la Chambre à nos écritures précédentes et nous répondrons de façon détaillée et circonstanciée à la requête des coprocureurs dans le cadre d'écriture à venir, conformément au règlement intérieur.
Just before we get the responses, because then it can perhaps be covered, I want to ask both counsel the same question. And this is only, I'm not touching on the legal issues raised, but on the practical concerns. So that's basically the second issue counsel Copper raised, which is lack of time and or resources. Now, obviously, the chamber can't provide more resources, so my question is, have requests been made to the Office of Administration to get more resources?
Numerous times, but the answer is very clear.
We are in desperate need of extra staff, consultants, and consultants. Can you put a number to additional time, number of days or whatever?
Judge Fence, I brought the preparation for the Supreme Court Chamber for the appeal hearings. I brought that up because that's something that we're doing simultaneously. When we have hearings scheduled, the question arises whether we can even be in this courtroom hearing evidence on any subject. But up until now, we have not heard anything. So I suppose the million-dollar question of today is also, when are we going to have some appeal hearings? But that doesn't change the fact that we are preparing on a daily basis, for these hearings. We've had the response of prosecution and our appeal, so we know probably what the issues for debate are going to be. We filed, as I said, a sixth additional evidence request. So we are fully busy with prepping the appeal. And at one point, I don't think there will be even time to be busy in K002/02 on the evidence, close to the appeal hearing. So this is the situation that we are facing.
Counsel, I understand the overall problem, but we have to schedule. Obviously, as we have done before, we can adapt schedules. But as of today, and before you know today, what, if any, additional time to prepare would you need? I understand this can change in 3 weeks or whatever, but we need to make a decision. If we want to accommodate you, it would be helpful to get your understanding on what you would need now.
I understand what you're saying. The problem is really that most of those 8,000 pages, I haven't been able to read. It's been seen by some of our consultants, but it all has to go through me. I don't know. I mean, what I really should be doing is read all those 8,000 plus pages. I don't know when I should do that, and I don't really know how long I need for it.
few weeks. I mean, ultimately, I'm the only one always standing here. The prosecution has, I think, seven different prosecutors sitting there. I'm being in court every single day, and I don't really know when to read all those pages. So, I don't know, a few weeks.
Oui, je suis intéressé par cette référence aux 8000 pages parce qu'effectivement elle paraît extrêmement spectaculaire, mais de Copé doit-on sérieusement comprendre que depuis, il me semble, la fin de l'année dernière, peut-être le mois de novembre, peut-être même avant, des procès-verbaux du dossier 4 ont été communiqués et qu'on n'en avait lu aucune
page. Yes, but we have been in trial every day. We were busy with the appeal brief until the end of last year. Then we started trial. And like I said, the tsunami was unleashed. I only have 24 hours in a day. Maybe you have more. I don't have it.
Maître Copé, si je puis me permettre, simplement une petite remarque. Devant la Chambre de la Cour suprême, il me semble que vous avez fait état et que vous avez utilisé des procès-verbaux qui venaient du dossier 4. Quand vous dites que vous n'avez absolument pas eu le temps d'en prendre connaissance, je suis absolument
abasourdi. No, I haven't been saying that. Only 2 weeks ago, we filed an 87 request having six case four WRIs admitted as evidence. We filed a request with the Supreme Court Chamber to have case four WRIs admitted. We have been reading it. We have been reading case four WRIs in relation to the dam. But have we been able to read all 8,000 plus pages in a coherent way? No. The only thing that we can do is do word searches and hopefully find whatever we're looking for. But we haven't been able to sit down and actually read coherently all those pages from all those 500 individuals in case four. And that's the situation.
Oui, merci. Avant que les coprocureurs puissent répondre, peut-être que c'est bien qu'ils aient l'ensemble des arguments. Je dois dire, Monsieur le Président, qu'au fil de ces audiences où nous discutons de ces dossiers 03 et 04, je dois dire que je ressens vraiment un profond malaise sur cette façon dont, tout d'un coup, ce qui est du ressort des coprocureurs devient la charge de la défense. Je renvoie à nouveau à nos écritures sur 03-004, puisque on va nous opposer que nous n'aurions peut-être pas fait les demandes au niveau administratif pour avoir des personnes supplémentaires. On nous demande de dire de combien de temps, et à chaque fois, et c'est important au niveau du public de le dire, on a l'impression que la défense fait du dilatoire et demande du temps parce qu'elle ne fait pas son travail. Là, je pense qu'il y a un moment, il faut dire les choses clairement. Il y a un problème de procédure. C'est dur, qui est certain qu'il faut régler en amont. Comme nous vous l'avons dit dans nos écritures en réponse, on pourra parler de temps lorsqu'on aura déjà fait le tri sur les documents qui devraient, en termes de la procédure, être communiqués à la défense et à la chambre et qui devraient être utilisables par les parties. Ça, c'est un premier point. Si on ne fait pas ce premier tri-là, je ne vois pas comment nous on va pouvoir dire qu'on a besoin de tant de temps. Si on est en train de nous dire que, en même temps que notre procès 002/2 on va avoir une masse de documents qui va revenir continuellement et qu'en fait, on est de facto également mis en examen dans les investigations et dans les instructions 03-004. Clairement, là, le temps, c'est on attend que les instructions se terminent. Comme ça, c'est fait. Donc, il y a un problème de procédure en amont à régler. Une fois que ce problème de procédure sera réglé, à savoir qu'est-ce qui est normalement susceptible d'être communiqué, les documents à décharge, les documents qui sont en relation avec des témoins qui avaient été prévus par les procureurs et par les parties. Et enfin, troisièmement, de façon exceptionnelle, l'utilisation de la requête 87.4 pour des éléments nouveaux, mais exceptionnelle. Et là, on est dans une sorte de imbéglio et une ratatouille de choses qui est absolument insupportable du côté de la défense. Je suis, encore une fois, un peu gêné de voir que nous sommes toujours dans cette position de devoir nous justifier sur des choses que nous n'aurions pas faites. Nous avons indiqué à plusieurs reprises au cours de ces audiences et également dans nos écritures sur les communications comment nous procédons. Oui, quand il y a un segment qui se passe, on essaye de faire des recherches sur des documents qui sont en lien avec les témoins, sur des documents qui sont en lien avec certains sites et des documents qui sont a priori versés en preuve ou qui sont susceptibles d'être à décharge. Et encore une fois, la jurisprudence internationale nous a indiqué que c'est normalement au coprocureur de les indiquer. Donc aujourd'hui, j'entends bien que vous avez besoin de vous organiser pour savoir comment programmer les audiences et comment programmer les prochains témoins à venir et comment programmer les segments. Encore une fois, nous vous donnons un mode opératoire dans notre requête. Il y a des choses qui sont très claires. Maintenant, si on nous dit que nous sommes également partis, mais sans droit dans des instructions en cours, là, on va avoir encore une fois un grave problème de procédure. Ça veut dire que nous ne sommes pas en mesure de continuer ce procès. Il faut trouver quelle est la limite. Et je ne peux pas accepter qu'à chaque fois, on donne l'impression, en tout cas, c'est l'impression que nous avons du côté de l'équipe de Que Sent-on, de devoir justifier, qu'émander ici et là des jours sans savoir exactement où on va et en allant à l'aveugle, parce que finalement, on nous annonce encore des communications à venir et nous ne savons pas exactement sur quel pied danser. Donc, pour répondre à votre question, Madame la juge Fens, sur la question du délai, tant que nous n'aurons pas une décision par rapport au modus operandi que nous proposons sur les communications, ça va être très compliqué de vous donner un nombre de jours sur le nombre de jours dont nous aurons besoin. Concrètement, ça dépendra du nombre de déclarations qui seront, qui correspondront à ce que nous pensons être les obligations de communication des coprocureurs.
លោកស្រីចក្រមមានទំនួរអ្វីសួរភិគីមេធាវីការពារក្តីឲ្យច្បាស់លាស់ដើម្បីបញ្ចប់នៅបញ្ហាភិគីម្ខាងនឹង ឲ្យជ្រះសាឡាស់មុននឹងផ្ដល់វេទិកាឲ្យភិគីម្ខាងទៀតឆ្លើយតបដែរឬទេ
Thank you, Mr. President, Your
Honours.
Let me try to respond to everything we've heard today, which I must say sounds very much like a response to our motion. And that would be my first point. We should not be interrupting the hearing of a witness for 40 minutes and then planning to file trial briefs 10 days down the road. If the defense wish to argue this issue now, as they have, that's fine. But I don't think they should be getting two kicks at the can. Second, counsel asked to bring this issue to your attention yesterday morning. He had plenty of time to circulate an email giving us some advance notice of what it was that he was going to ask the chamber. This is becoming a repeating thing, stunts by the defense counsel without any notice to the parties of the request. The stunt today included putting a question to the national co-prosecutor, who's not here today. If he wished to put a question to the national co-prosecutor, and first, let me add that she is certainly under no obligation to explain the law to counsel, but if he wanted her to be here, perhaps he should have told everyone in advance what he was going to ask for today. A second, we heard an assertion that we were late in requesting these witnesses. That is simply and utterly false. As he noted himself, we made requests for two of the witnesses in our May 2014 filing, and the third witness is a new one that we have discovered. Your honors should take note that in our May 2014 witness list, while the state of evidence that had been made available to us in case 4 was not what it is now, there was lower level cadres at that point who had started to come clean on the policy to identify and smash the Cham people. Based on that, we included these witnesses. Since that time, the investigation has continued, and commune chiefs and a district chief have now come clean and testified to the existence of orders from above to identify and kill all of the Cham. Council should have known of this evidence. I simply do not believe they were unaware of it. He says we buried this in a tsunami. Nothing could be further from the truth. The interviews of the district chief, four were conducted in 2013, one in 2014. Interestingly, they were not posted by the investigating judge until December 2014, all five of those interviews, obviously because of the sensitivity of the information being provided by this individual. When the interviews were posted in December 2014, we made a request, immediate request for authorization. When we got that authorization, they were disclosed in February 2015. And this is a very important point. We made a separate filing, disclosure filing, of just the five interviews of that district chief. If you go back to the filing, the disclosure was of those five interviews only. Everybody knows who this person is and the importance of her. To stand here and suggest to the court that they were unaware of the importance of this evidence and that we tried to bury it is appalling. Judge Laverne has already pointed out that while they stand here and say they don't have time to review this, they seem to be doing quite a good job in the appeal proceedings where they are repeatedly filing new evidence requests based on these very same interviews, the case 4 interviews. They also used them in the Trapping Khmer segment. They used them extensively with witnesses in court without filing 87 form motions, and that's fine from our end, including the Khieu Samphan defense team. Just a few weeks ago, she was in this courtroom questioning a witness in the Trapping Khmer segment using one of these interviews that now all of a sudden some great principle should prevent the court from looking at the truth. I don't think another point was made. regarding the trial chamber, I don't think it is correct that these witnesses have been rejected. They weren't included in the initial selection of trial witnesses. It may be that the trial chamber was considering them more as policy witnesses. I'm not sure, but there has certainly been no ruling rejecting these witnesses, nor could I think that there could be. I don't think there can be any question about the importance of this evidence. The central issue here is why. Why were the Cham people rounded up and killed in these locations? This evidence will put an end to an academic argument that has been going on for years. Was there a policy? Yes. We now have people, district chiefs, who have provided evidence that there was a clear policy to identify and kill Cham people in these core areas where they live. Let me get to probably what the most important issue is, the procedure. The fact, the argument that there is an ongoing investigation and that therefore we should delay this segment. That is not different than other areas of the case. Counsel is right. This is a particularly key area of the case, but it is no different than any other area. Investigations will continue. We will continue to disclose interviews where there are new ones. And there is a procedure available should there be new significant evidence that either the defense or the prosecution wishes the trial chamber to hear. So there simply is no reason to stop this segment because there is an ongoing investigation. And we certainly agree where the defense, where reasonable requests are being made, the court should give the defense time where they need it. But I think to ask that we postpone the segment until the end of trial is unwarranted. Moreover, we have only one more witness relating to the Khong Mias killings, which I think was what counsel was proposing, that we proceed back to the east zone side of Khmer. We only have today's witness, so I don't think asking that we postpone the Khong Mias part of this trial, where we have this one witness left, a victim who will describe what happened to the Cham people, I don't think that's warranted. Should the chamber grant our request to hear these witnesses, they're not going to be heard for a while. I assume it would be not until sometime in October after the break. In my view, that's sufficient time, but certainly the chamber can consider how much time the defense needs. But I do want to make it very clear there should be no surprise at all about these witnesses. I think that responds to Mr. Kope's points regard to the Kusum Khan team. Again, you may have been wondering, as we are, what brought about this recent flip-flop from them, where they had been using these case four interviews in court. They had not been opposing our requests to put them into evidence. And then all of a sudden, a few weeks ago, it becomes a matter of principle that we must not hear any of this evidence anymore. I would submit that in all likelihood, at some point a few weeks ago, they became aware when they were preparing for the Cham case of these key interviews, this critical evidence that is obviously damaging to the defense. But put that aside, this court has an obligation to ascertain the truth. Both sides, prosecution and defense, have the right to request new evidence where it meets the criteria under the rules. This evidence certainly does, these new interviews. The defense have the right to oppose that. They didn't when we put this evidence forward. This is critical evidence, Your Honors, and as indicated in our motion, we believe it's critical, essential that the court hear this. If you have any questions, I'll stay on my feet, but I think I've responded to the defense, my list of issues from the defense.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, et bonjour à tous. Quelques observations qui tiendront lieu de réponse à la requête du coprocureur international. Nous n'entendons pas faire de réponse écrite à cette requête. Je souhaiterais redire ce que je dis à chaque fois quand nous avons un débat sur cette question, que nous parlons de notre position qui est particulière dans ce procès, puisque nous soutenons l'action publique qui est portée par le bureau des coprocureurs, mais que nous le faisons de manière autonome et que les co-avocats principaux n'ont pas accès au dossier 3 et 4 et que nous sommes donc exactement dans la même situation que la défense dans l'accès à ces documents, tout en sachant bien évidemment que nous n'avons pas le même rôle dans ce procès. Pour être moi aussi très honnête et pour que la Chambre comprenne les difficultés que peuvent rencontrer les parties, je suis obligée de dire que nous n'avions pas vu venir cette requête et que nous n'avions pas pris connaissance entièrement des documents relatifs aux témoins de TCW 938. La raison pour laquelle je dis ceci, c'est pour que la Chambre comprenne aussi la charge de travail à laquelle doivent faire face toutes les parties, chacune dans leur rôle et avec leurs différentes fonctions à l'intérieur de la salle d'audience et à l'extérieur de la salle d'audience. Et pour la section des co-avocats principaux, la charge de travail à l'extérieur de la salle d'audience est aussi particulièrement importante. Nous pouvons donc comprendre que la défense puisse demander un certain temps pour prendre connaissance de ces documents. Nous avons, nous aussi, des difficultés pour lire, digérer et comprendre les informations qui sont divulguées, tout en réitérant ce que nous avons toujours dit depuis le début de ce procès, c'est qu'il est dans l'intérêt des parties civiles que nous puissions continuer à avancer de manière régulière dans le respect des droits de chacun. Nous ne nous sommes jamais opposés en tant que tels à la demande d'une quelconque partie quant à la convocation d'un témoin. Nous en sommes toujours rapportés à la discrétion et à la sagesse du tribunal. C'est ce que nous entendons faire pour cette requête précise. Il y a manifestement un problème récurrent dont nous supportons tous les conséquences dans ce procès. Il va falloir à un moment que nous ayons un verdict de la Cour suprême dans le dossier 2-1 avant la fin de ce procès, parce que bien évidemment il y a des implications directes entre la décision qui sera prise par la Cour suprême et les audiences qui se déroulent actuellement dans cette salle d'audience. Et il faudra se poser à un moment la question de la fin des enquêtes dans les dossiers 3 et 4 avant la fin des audiences dans le procès 2-2. Ceci étant dit, je voudrais réagir à l'un des points mentionnés par notre confrère Copé sur Ta'an, parce que du côté des parties civiles, ce qui nous intéresse, c'est la recherche de la vérité. Nous savons par les informations publiques accessibles sur le site internet de la Cour que Ta'an a été mise en examen, non pas pour des crimes de génocide, mais pour des crimes contre l'humanité, notamment des crimes de persécution religieuse et des crimes reliés à la pagode de Otrakoun, dont nous parlons très régulièrement depuis le début du segment sur Hicham, il faudra un moment que la Chambre se pose la question de savoir si Tal doit être convoqué pour s'expliquer dans le dossier de Dur. Il n'y a aucun obstacle procédural à ce que la Chambre, proprio mutu, décide d'entendre Ta'an, qui semble avoir fait le choix de coopérer avec la Cour, puisqu'il n'a pas été mis en examen in absentia, mais puisqu'apparemment, au regard des informations publiques sur le site internet et du communiqué de presse qui est sorti, il a fait le choix de se présenter à sa mise en examen. Donc, il n'y aurait aucun obstacle à ce que Ta'an soit aujourd'hui convoqué par la Chambre, compte tenu des informations qu'il semble posséder et qui pourraient être particulièrement pertinentes à la manifestation de la vérité sur un, voire plusieurs segments de ce procès. Nous ne ferons pas cette requête, mais nous souhaitons alerter la Chambre sur cette possibilité. Voilà mes observations, Monsieur le Président, Madame, Messieurs du Tribunal. Merci de votre attention.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Let me first say that I'm quite pleased with the support from the lead co-lawyer for the civil parties. I'm quite pleased to hear that also they, despite their very good connections with the prosecution, did not see that request coming. Sarcastically, Mr. Lysak called our motions a stunt. Well, that really wasn't, and I'm very happy that the lead co-lawyers are supporting us in this respect now. They had no idea about the potential importance of this witness. And I'm actually quite convinced, Mr. President, that the trial chamber itself didn't see that coming either. So to just accuse us of some stunt is quite outrageous, I must say. My second point, Mr. President, it's all very nice what the international co-prosecutor is saying, but I'm really interested in what the national co-prosecutor has to say in respect to my request for clarification. He is entitled to respond, I presume, on behalf of the Office of the National Co-Prosecutor. If Mrs. Chia Lang is not there, we don't have any problem with this. She is fully capable, I'm sure, in giving the perspective of the National Co-Prosecutor. So I would really like to hear his view as to why they didn't co-sign that request that we are now discussing.
Oui, Maître Copé, j'aimerais comprendre un peu plus votre demande concernant la demande de clarification que vous adressez au procureur cambodgien. Est-ce que vous entendez contester la validité de la requête formulée par le seul co-procureur international? J'avoue ne pas très bien comprendre. Et quelle est la pertinence de cette demande au regard de la procédure actuellement en cours?
Well, in our written submissions in response to this motion, we can only speculate as to the reasons of why the National Co-Prosecutor is not co-signed. We can have an idea, but we really do not know. That's why in court, in the place where it all should happen, I'm requesting, I have requested the National Co-Prosecutor, if it's possible, according to Cambodian law, to even ask for a witness only by the international co-prosecutor. I remember only 2 weeks ago, Judge Fence said when I walked away angrily, it doesn't matter as long as the national lawyer is here, it's all fine. But here we have a mirror situation. It's the international co-prosecutor asking only for this witness, whereas before it was a co-signed request. So I'm mistaken about Cambodian law, but I think it should be the national co-prosecutor requesting the trial chamber to call for a witness, to summon the
យើងអត់យល់ដែរឥឡូវនឹងដូចជាបោះរត់យោហើយយើងដូចអាចផ្ដាល់តួនាទីនឹងម្នាក់ម្នាក់និយាយច្បាស់លាស់ហើយឥឡូវព្រះញ្ញាងើបទៀតព្រះញ្ញារងើផងហើយព្រះញ្ញាធំអន្តរជាតិនឹងងើបទៀតយើងបាននិយាយច្បាស់លាស់ហើយមិនឲ្យភាគីម្ខាងធ្វើការអធិប្បាយឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ហើយភាគីម្ខាងទៀតសំបីតែចៅក្រមនឹងក៏យើងឲ្យនិយាយឲ្យបានច្បាស់លាស់ដែរយើងមិនចង់ឲ្យត្រឡប់ត្រឡិនម្ដងហើយទៅវិញទៅមកចឹងទេ
ព្រះញ្ញារងជាតិមានបញ្ហាអីឆ្លើយអាចឆ្លើយតបឬបញ្ហានេះទេសូមគោរពលោកប្រធានខ្ញុំយល់ថាអ្វីដែលលោកគូពេលើកឡើងនេះគឺព្រឹកនេះគឺជាការឆ្លើយតបទៅនឹងសារណាតរបស់កែឡាយសហប្រញ្ញាហើយដូច្នេះខ្ញុំមិនមានកាតព្វកិច្ចអ្វីត្រូវឆ្លើយជំនួសសហប្រញ្ញា
ជាតិនោះទេបើលោកគូពេមានបញ្ហាអាចទៅសេចូលនៅក្នុងសាធារណៈរបស់គាត់ទៅដើម្បីឲ្យយើងមានលទ្ធភាពក្នុងការឆ្លើយតបឲ្យបានជាក់លាក់សូមអរគុណបាទអរគុណរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីយោបល់លើកឡើងជុំវិញបញ្ហានានាពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងសំណើសុំរបស់សហប្រញ្ញាអន្តរជាតិដែលបានដាក់សំណើ សូមស្ដាប់សេចក្តីកម្មសាក់សីបន្ថែមហើយនឹងដាក់ឲ្យសូមឲ្យអនុវត្តទទួលយកឯកសារថ្មីបន្ថែមដែលមានបញ្ហានេះពេលនេះហើយរដ្ឋមន្ត្រីយោបល់នេះអង្គជំរះនឹងយកទៅពិនិត្យពិចារណាគួបផ្សំនិងសំណើសុំដែលភាគីសហមិត្តភាពការពារក្តីទាំងពីរក្រុមបានលើកឡើងថាខ្លួននឹងដាក់បន្ថែមនៅសេចក្តីជំទាស់ជាលិលាអសរ នេះពេលនេះហើយនឹងនៅសប្តាហ៍ក្រោយឆាប់ៗនេះដើម្បីអង្គជំរះនឹងយកមកពិនិត្យពិចារណាគួបគ្នានឹងសម្រេចចុងក្រោយលើបញ្ហានេះតែទោះបីយ៉ាងណាក៏ដោយបញ្ហាលើកឡើងនៅពេលនេះគឺមានចំនួនច្រើនយើងបញ្ហាខ្លះគឺអង្គជំរះត្រូវពិនិត្យពិចារណាទៅដោះស្រាយពោះមុខភ្លាមៗហើយរឿងខ្លះត្រូវតែដោះស្រាយជាបន្តបន្ទាប់រហូតដល់បានសម្រេចលើទាំងស្រុងលើសំណើនិងសេចក្តីជំទាស់របស់ភាគីពាក់ព័ន្ធនឹងបញ្ហានេះ ឥឡូវនេះដល់ពេលសំត្របនឹងសម្រាកដែរហើយអំពីប្រកាសសម្រាកចាប់ពីនេះទៅទៅរហូតដល់ម៉ោង10:20នាទីអញ្ជើញចូលវិញដើម្បីបន្តកិច្ចដំណើរការសកម្មភាពសម្រាកចុះ
សូមអញ្ជើញក្រោកឈរ